application has several elements. The first is a three-story, 102-room hotel along Second Street, which will include a pool and a lounge area, and you'll hear a good deal more about that. The second is a 400-seat restaurant with indoor and outdoor seating. The third is a rooftop deck with 200 seats. The fourth is a public marina, which must remain public under the redevelopment agreement, which I'll speak about momentarily, with certain ancillary uses such as a ship store, 137 boat slips, dry storage for the winter. We also have a liquor license, parking for 246 spaces, which is more parking than the total of every other competing facility in the area, including those of the objectors. And finally, we have two public access easements, as would be required by CAFRA. Now, the property is in the Marine Commercial Zone. It also is part of the Maritime District Redevelopment Area. As a consequence of being within a redevelopment area, the application of the law is a bit different than what would be the case were this a typical zoning application. Let me start with the way the redevelopment plan is structured. The redevelopment plan essentially contains certain provisions which require which anticipate certain types of hotel development at this site. The interstices, the omissions in the plan are to be filled by the requirements of the Marine Commercial Zone. The Marine Commercial Zone at 212-15 permits 15 uses. So it's possible for a developer to develop this property in accordance with the Marine Commercial Zone. Among those 15 uses are the RA, residential A, single family dwellings, RB, two family dwellings, outdoor boat storage, and indoor boat storage in buildings that can be two stories or higher. The zoning at this location has not been conducive to development. It has remained fallow for many years. As a consequence, the governing body took advantage of a statute which the legislature enacted in 1992 called the Local Redevelopment and Housing Law. That statute is designed to encourage development of underutilized properties and to extend the authority of local governments by allowing them to enter into redevelopment agreements that include requirements they could not impose on a developer who proceeded to wish to proceed under the zoning ordinance. The redevelopment statute affords greater authority to a municipality than it would have under a zoning ordinance. Now, the process for redevelopment consists of four steps. The first is a designation of property as being an area in need of redevelopment. Statute contains approximately 5 or 6 different criteria that have to be satisfied. Basically, if the property is significantly underutilized for many, many years, it satisfies that test. The second is the adoption of a redevelopment. A redevelopment plan has already been adopted, and we have to adhere to the requirements of the redevelopment plan. The third is the designation of a redeveloper and the execution of a redevelopment agreement. That also has been accomplished, and that is the vehicle that that a governing body can, and in this case has used, to extract commitments from a developer that it could not obtain in the zoning context. And the last step is the step we're here for today, and that is land use board review. I said a few moments ago that one of the advantages to a municipality of proceeding under the redevelopment law is the ability to the governing body to require commitments from a redeveloper it could not require in a zoning context. As this board is aware, if an applicant comes in with a fully compliant plan, they're guaranteed an as-of-right approval, and there's a limitation as to the number and types of conditions that can be imposed in that context. The redevelopment law is different. It anticipates the negotiation of a redevelopment agreement. And in this case, we have negotiated a redevelopment agreement that contains significant commitments on behalf of the applicant this evening. Number one, we are prohibited from converting the marina to a private marina or to any type of condominium ownership. It must be a public marina. Number two, the redevelopment plan specifies what the attributes of marina, The redevelopment agreement specifies what the attributes of that marina must be, what type of storage it must have, what type of facility it must have. Third, the redevelopment agreement specifies design criteria for the hotel and restaurant, none of which are included in your zoning ordinance. Fourth, we are required to undertake certain commitments to allow parking for the Marlin and Tuna Club and the Beach Haven Charter Fisherman, 20 spaces for the former, 9 for the latter. None of this could be required or even asked for in the context of a traditional zoning ordinance. Finally, attached to the redevelopment agreement is Exhibit B, which is a description of what this project entails. We understand that there is some public opposition to this application, and there is some public support for this application. Oddly, some of the opposition stems from opposition to achieving the very goal of the redevelopment law, to turn a fallow site into a site that has economic value to a municipality. And there are advantages and disadvantages to every project, but we believe you will conclude that the advantages far outweigh what the disadvantages could be. The test this evening, thus, is not whether or not this developer should be the developer. It's not whether or not the redevelopment plan is appropriate. It is whether or not we satisfy the criteria of the redevelopment plan and where relevant to zoning ordinance. If we receive an approval, we understand that we have to go to the Department of Environmental Protection and seek approvals under the Coastal Area Facility Review Act and any other statute that impacts this property. This evening, we hope to have 4 witnesses. The first will be Gary Vecchio, who is the engineer who prepared the site plan for the project. The second is Craig Brearley, who is a local architect, who was the architect for the hotel, the restaurant, and for the structures at the site. The third is Betsy Dolan, who is an expert in traffic issues, who will provide testimony on the impact of traffic on this community, which I think everyone will conclude is de minimis. Finally, the last witness is Karen Propuso. Ms. Propuso's sole purpose is to talk briefly about what other permits are required and what CAFRA will require if this application is approved. As I indicated at the outset, it was our hope that Mr. Vernon would be our first witness, because he's in Pennsylvania at the funeral of his friend, and I think some of you might have even seen him, the rest in peace sticky sign, he could not make it this evening. So with that introduction, I'd like to call as my first witness Gary Vecchio. I believe you marked some exhibits at the last meeting, the application. Were any of you marked as board exhibits?
No.
We would ask that the application be marked as board exhibits. Mr. Little's letter, the application is the applicant's exhibit. Mr. Little's letter and the CME letter as board exhibits.
Go through them one more time. The application is going to be board exhibit or your
the R.
They want the application. And Mr. Little's letter will be D1.
Use the microphone.
Can't hear.
Want to move?
They're not needed. D2's gonna be Mr. Little's December letter.
That's the December 20 letter.
What do you want to be?
That's December 20th, 2019.
The applicant's application will be A1. Mr. Little's letter will be B1. And Jim's letter will be B2. Did you want to put any of your experts, you want to have me swear in your expert and mark your other exhibits?
The only other exhibit I would like to mark before I swear in is the redevelopment agreement. I think that should be part of the record as well.
You want that as B3, or would you rather have it?
Perhaps A2, if that's okay. Okay, will that be marked then?
Yeah, that will be marked. Mr. Raven said that he proposed the list earlier, so I was working off his list, I apologize.
Okay, here you go.
At the way next to you.
I'm sorry, but could the redevelopment agreement be A14, because we pre-marked other exhibits and that will be so.
That'd be wrong. A14 is the redevelopment agreement.
Thank you.
Fill in the rest later. Sir, do you swear that testimony you're giving is the truth?
I do.
And your name and address and your credentials?
It's Gary D. Vecchio. 16 Olympia Drive, Marlton, New Jersey. I'm a civil engineer. I graduated 1987 from the University of Buffalo, Bachelor of Science. Professional engineer in the states of New Jersey, Pennsylvania, New York, and Delaware. I worked for Taylor Wiseman Taylor for 32 years as a site civil engineer.
Mr. Vecchio, as a civil engineer, can you tell what area you essentially focus your practice in?
Yes, I prepare site plans, site civil grading, drainage, utilities, permitting.
And over the years, approximately how many site plans have you prepared?
Several hundred.
And have you had the opportunity to appear before development review boards, either land use or planning boards, in connection with site plans that you prepared?
Yes, the New Jersey hundreds.
And have you had the opportunity to prepare site plans for boards sitting in Ocean County?
Yes, I have.
Now, you retained to prepare the site plan for the application that's before the board this evening?
Yes, I have.
And let me start out by saying, did you make an examination to determine what the existing conditions were at this site?
Yes, we did an existing condition survey.
I'm just wondering, I have a hard copy where I should put that.
This is an aerial exhibit. If I could just say existing conditions I can talk about.
Will you tell the board what exhibit A2 is, please?
It's an aerial exhibit of the existing parcel.
And can you tell me how A2 came about to be prepared?
A2 was prepared, it shows 2nd Street along the south. North is up, Pennsylvania, avenues to the east. This is 3rd Street to the east. The existing maintenance facility is this building right here. This is the existing ship store at the intersection. The restaurant that was destroyed was along the western portion here. It's not there now. And there is a Marlin Tuna Club that's on the northern portion. And the existing marina right now has 137 boat slips in the center parcel. The project has two lots, a larger lot, which is to the west of Pennsylvania Avenue and north of Second Street, and the parcel is 8 acres. And if you take the water portion out, it leaves 3.5 acres of uplands. There's a second parcel, it's 0.08 acres, and it's south of 3rd Street, north of 2nd Street, east of Pennsylvania Avenue. It is this vacant parcel, no structures.
And parcel to the south, bottom of that, you just tell the board what that consists of, what kind of development that is?
Yes, south, as you go from the Pennsylvania Avenue and 2nd Street, it is residential to the east. These are single-family homes, you can't really see them here. And as you go more towards the Bay Area, it becomes, this is residential, and it goes down to, there's commercial, this is Birds and Betty's, our restaurant. And then the public parking area is also along the south. And then you hit the waters to the west, the Bay, and waters to the north. Pennsylvania Avenue is a dead end at the 2 1/4.
Do a determination of what the lot coverage is, the impervious coverage is of the property at issue tonight?
Yes, both parcels is 100% impervious coverage.
Now, are you familiar, or are you not, with the development proposed on this property, is that correct?
Yes, I do.
And will you tell the board, first in general terms, what's envisioned?
The proposal, I'd like to go to another exhibit.
Yeah, sure. Before we go to that next exhibit, might I just offer A2 in evidence? Thank you. Before we talk about the uses, can you identify A3 for the board, please?
Yes, this is the proposed Arena Hotel restaurant site plan. It's a colored version of the site plan that was submitted in the township.
And is it part of the application, a black and white version, part of the application before this board?
Yes, it is.
And is this A3 an exhibit that was prepared by you or under your supervision?
Yes, it is.
In general terms, before we talk about the specifics, can you tell the board what the proposed development for the site entails?
Yes, it's a proposed hotel, 102 rooms, ground floor parking, and then 3 stories. If you go to the west, this is where the restaurant was destroyed. This will also be a restaurant. And the Shift store, which is at the corner of Pennsylvania Avenue and 2nd Street, will be relocated to be in this restaurant area. The existing Shift store will be the check-in, front desk, clubhouse area. It'll be renovated. Between the two buildings, there's a landscape area, park benches, sitting area, and the red is the pavers. And then we have a pool as you go north and lounge area. And in part of the marina maintenance building, there'll be also a snack bar on the western side of that. Way up to the north, we have a pavilion, a bar, snack bar up there. It's an 18 by 36 open structure.
We'll return shortly to the specifics, but can you just tell the board where the parking areas are on the site?
Yes, if you can look at this exhibit, they're labeled with letters. A is ground parking. There's 39 on the first level. B was the second parcel, the off-site. That's 43 parking spaces. C, we call this the wharf area on the north. That has 29 spaces. And D is the, we call this flexible parking. This is where the boat storage is. It's 135 parking spots can be there as well.
Now, one of the requirements requirements, one of the elements of the site plan are access easements. Can you show the board where they are, please?
Yes, we have public access easement along the bay area. It's the western side here. It's a 10-foot by 144-foot long easement. The second one is up by the Barlow Tuna Club. It's 6 feet. It goes along the wharf area. It's the blue.
Now, let's return, if you might, to the parking. Did you undertake to do a calculation of the number of spaces required by the Beach Haven ordinance for a project of this nature?
Yes, I have.
And can you tell the board first how you went about computing the necessary parking?
Yes. The total number of parking spots by ordinance was 186. We obtained that by the different uses. Hotel, 102 rooms. One room per space was 102. We have the restaurant at 29 spaces, one space per 600 square feet. And we have 17,540 square feet. The clubhouse, we needed 9 spaces. That's one space per 600 square feet. We have 5,390 square feet. Boat slips, it's 45 spaces. That's one space per 3 slips. There's 137 of them. In the Marine Bar, the Lily Bar, one space for 600 square feet, and that is 400 square feet. So the total, when you add them up, is 186.
Now, of the with regard to fulfilling the 186 space requirement, can you tell the board where the parking on site is located and how much it totals?
Yes, the I just went over that before. A is 39, is the ground parking. B, this is 43. C, 29, and D is 135. When you add that all up, it's 246 spaces, so there's excess.
Now, besides the excess, is there additional parking available in the area?
Yes, we've also made some spaces along 2nd Street, parallel parking. We were able to make 15 parallel parking spaces, and we've also made more spaces. We have 21 along the eastern side of Pennsylvania Avenue, and we also have 29 on the western side of Pennsylvania Avenue.
But those spaces are not counted in the 246 that you computed, is that correct?
That is correct.
Now, the applicant has undertaken to commit to provide a certain amount of parking spaces to the Tuna Club. Are you aware of that?
Yes, I am.
And can you show the board where that would be?
Yes, that's the western portion of Pennsylvania Avenue.
And the charter organization, we committed to provide 9 spaces. Can you tell me where that would be?
The 9 spaces is on the same 29 spaces. There's 20 for the Marlin Tuna Club, and there's 9 for the charter fishing pool.
Now, part of that property is, part of that parking area is on Mr. Vernon's property or the applicant's property, and part is the public right of way. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Now, we also have an obligation to provide handicap parking, is that correct?
That is correct.
And can you show the board where the handicap spaces are located?
Yes, we have 11 handicap spaces. We try to put them in different parts of the site for the amenities. If you go up to the northern portion by the pavilion bar, there's 2 handicap spaces in the wharf area. If you go down to the pool area, there's 5 park handicap spaces there. This is also going to be used for check-in. And there's 2 more in the off-site parking area B. And underneath the ground level, there's 2 handicap spaces near the restaurant.
And how was it made determined that 11 spaces would be required?
That was by ordinance.
I neglected to inquire. Does Mr. Byrne have a plan for valet parking?
Yes, he does.
Can you explain to the board how that would operate?
Yes, basically it's the major one is D. He has 135 spaces. This is if you normally park with 9x18 spaces and 24-foot aisles. If you do valet parking, you can get more parking spots in here if it's done by valet.
And do you have an approximate number of how many more parking spots you may be able to get in there?
Yes, we got, let me see, we went from 135 to 231 in that parcel. We're also looking at the area B where we had 43 spaces. We believe we get nearly 99 in that one as well.
Now, what does the ordinance require as far as the dimensions of each parking space?
9 by 18.
And what are the dimensions of the parking spaces at this, this site?
9 by 18.
And what is the ordinance, what is required for a handicap space dimensions?
Well, we have two different kinds of handicap spaces. We have the ones for cars, which are 13 feet, and we have ones that are for vans, and vans are 16 feet. We have both types on this project.
Now, did you determine, let's strike that, determine drive aisles? Can you, does that have a meaning to engineers such as yourself?
Yes, that's our ingress, egress. We have drive aisles for the parking lot. Off Pennsylvania, off 3rd Street is 24 foot. Then we have the 9 by 18 parking spaces. And we also have another 24 foot drive aisle and exit here on 2nd Street.
That entrance would be on the southeast portion of the property, is that right?
That is correct. And we have the other entrance here. This is a wider one. 3rd Street's 34 feet, so we matched that up 34 feet. We also have, this is where the boats are, so we wanted that wider, so it's more than typical 24 feet.
Now, how is it that strike that? Is there a requirement as to the width of drive aisles? How do you go about determining what's required?
That's ordinance. Okay.
And does the drive aisle width here satisfy the ordinance requirements?
Yes.
Now, did you seek to assess whether or not the turning radiuses are appropriate for this site?
Yes.
And could you tell the board first what you did and then what you concluded?
Yes, we ran emergency vehicles through the site. We prepared a circulation plan, which is part of the site. We were able to get emergency vehicles to the warp area, turn around, come back out. We had emergency vehicles go through this area between the hotel and the restaurant, and they can turn around and come out as well.
Now, one of the comments in Mr. Little's letter was that several spaces in parking lot A could not be accessed. He was concerned. Do you recall that?
Yes.
And can you show the board first where that is and how that was dealt with?
Yeah. Yes, we originally had three parking spaces in the western and northwestern corner here, which eliminated them, so now we have 39 parking spaces. The cars, this is one way. This is an entrance in, and it's an entrance out. We have proper signage, and we're going to have painted arrows within the underground.
Now, just for record purposes, if you would just specify where on A3 the entrance to the parking area A is.
It's the eastern entrance.
And where is the exit?
The western.
And where are the other entrances to the structures on the site? Can you just show where they are, please?
No, there is no. There's just two. You mean ingress? Yeah, just to these.
Okay. Are there pedestrian sidewalks located throughout the site?
Yes.
And can you tell the board, first of all, what color they are so they can see
them? They're the red, and these are going to be the brick pavers.
And why is it that you opted to use brick pavers?
We tried to match the master plan.
And can you show the board the area where sidewalks are located?
Yes, it's the western portion of Pennsylvania Avenue along the frontage. And then we have the northern side of 2nd Street along the frontage. And then we're going to have the public access. We're going to have the sidewalk in there along the bay. You'll be able to go all the way up this little peninsula. In here, there's benches and there's fire pits. So there's amenities here and a bait shop. There's a bait shop right there at the ship store.
Bait shop would be the southwest corner.
Yeah, southwest corner. And it's the red sidewalk. We connect to the entrances and exit of the hotel. And then we connect to the landscape garden area. There's sitting area, there's four benches, plantings, lots of plantings. And then we have the pool, lounge area. It's connected there, and it comes up to the check-in clubhouse.
Now, there are certain red hatched areas in the right-of-way of Pennsylvania Avenue. Can you just tell the board what that is, please?
Yes, that's It's a traffic feature. This is to have traffic coming. This is what cars drive, and they got a different texture. It slows them down. So we added two at the intersection to slow cars down.
And that is something the applicant could put in if the board wishes or if the board doesn't desire it.
Yes, he offered that. It wasn't required.
With regard to amenities, you pointed out where benches are. Could you just show the board where on the site benches are located?
Yes, there's benches along the wharf area, and there's benches along the peninsula, and there's benches along the garden area, and there's also bike racks. We tried to put bike racks over by the clubhouse area.
And approximately how many bikes within the bike racks you were up again?
They're about 10.
Did you also undertake to prepare a landscape plan?
Yes, I did.
Can I just add today, can we be more conservative, Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Yes, this is a colored version of the landscape and lighting plan that was submitted in the package to the borough.
And was that prepared by you or under your supervision?
Yes.
And just in very general terms, tell the board how you went about preparing this.
Yes. We had the big circles are street trees and shade trees. We tried to place them along the between the building and the sidewalk areas. We planted the English Garden here, garden landscape plan, extensive landscaping in here. It's a lot of ornamental trees along the marina area too. We have scattered either like shrubs and more street trees along the northern portion. It's a mixture of native vegetation.
And how is it that you came about the selection of vegetation that we have on the site?
It's the native one, and it's we have a landscape architect in the office who designed
it. And approximately, where's the height of the street trees? The
street trees are 12 to 14 feet. Yes, it does.
And first of all, in connection with the lighting, what criteria did you use? Did you develop this lighting plan?
Yes, I did.
And can you explain to the board what criteria you used to develop it?
Yes, Beach Haven has an ordinance, chapter 167.
And how did you go about implementing the requirements of that ordinance in your lighting plan?
That is to provide lighting for safety and security along sidewalks and parking areas.
And can you show the board where the lighting will be located on site?
Yes, there's lighting is provided along the wharf area, along the parking lot in D, and the parking lot near the pool area, and we're along the frontage of Second Street, and we're going to provide smaller lights along the peninsula.
And with regard to the light stations, the board have.
Yes, so what we did was we have the 25-foot LEDs in the big parking lots where the cars are, and we have the smaller 10-foot LEDs where it's just for pedestrians.
And What will be the power of these lights, how many lumens?
10,000 lumens.
And what, if any, effort has been made to prevent off-site spillage?
Yes, these are the modern LED lights. They throw the light down and the shield on the top.
And approximately what hours will the lights be operating?
These will be dusted on. Yeah,
this is page.
This is sheet 17 of Exhibit A4. Mr. Vecchio, will you first tell the board what this exhibit shows?
This shows the details of the lights.
And starting on the right-hand side, can you just explain what the light details will look like?
Yes, this is the top shield. It throws the light down. This one, I believe, is a 10-foot shorter one. This one is the 25-foot larger one. This one will be a parking lot. This one will be for sidewalks.
And how is it that you came to choose this design for the property?
Well, this is a modern light that's used today.
And while we're here, you show any bike racks or any other side of
the
exhibit?
Yes, we try to go through the master plan, and there's picnic tables, trash receptacles. This is part of the master plan, and the bike racks.
With regard to drainage, did you undertake to assess the drainage of this property?
Yes, I did.
And what is the current condition with regard to drainage? Huh?
It's 100% impervious.
And did you make an effort to satisfy the CAFRA requirements in connection with your drainage plan?
Yes, I did.
And can you explain to the board how you went about to do that?
And it's not just the CAFRA requirements, it's the borough of Beach Haven has drainage requirements, and what we're going to do is recharge the roof drainage from the hotel. We'll go into a pipe system with stone, filter fabric, and that'll take the water away from the existing municipal system, so there'll be less water going into the municipal system, which was part of the stormwater ordinance of the borough. We have a decrease in pervious area with the plantings that we have, so we're decreasing. The 100% will be closer to 91.7% for a big lot and 97.5% for a smaller lot, so there's less impervious.
And you used the concept of recharge. Can you first tell the board what that is?
Yes, one of the DEP CAFRA requirements is a 100% of the average pre-construction groundwater is recharged and maintain. So we're going to take what's going there now and provide more into the ground.
And the water that you're going to be recharged, will that be essentially a runoff from the roof?
Yes, we're using the roof water because that's a clean water.
And you understand that ultimately any kind of drainage will have to be approved by Division of Coastal Zone Management of DEP, is that correct?
Yes.
Now, with regard to utilities, can you tell the board how this property is served with potable water?
Yes, there's potable water along 2nd Street as well as Pennsylvania Avenue. We're working with the Public Works.
And what about sanitary sewer? Is that capacity available?
The capacity is available. We're also working with the Public Works of the borough.
And how is it that you go about obtaining a commitment for sanitary sewage work?
Well, we have to do, it's an application to the Public Works. We've been in contact that we have verbal commitments that there is capacity. We just have to work on the details if there's any upgrades.
solid waste recycling. Can you explain to the board where that's going to be on site?
Yes, there's two areas for trash collection. We have one along the rear where the pool is. It's the trucks will come in off Pennsylvania Avenue entrance, and the recycled area is 10x20 trash receptacle. And there's also a second one. There's a breezeway between the buildings here, and it's 24 foot wide and 80 foot long. And the trucks, which we've done the truck turning template, can go in there and recycle it. Right there is the trash receptacle, 10x20, shall be picked up.
And with regard to the loading zone, can you tell the board how loading zone loading will be handled with regard to deliveries?
Yes, the deliveries is also in the same area. Breezeway is 24 foot wide, 80 foot long. It is the southwest corner. The deliveries will be off the street. There was a little confusion about the striping here. The striping here is no parking. That's what the striping is here, so it blocks this entrance.
Now, with regard to fuel for the marina, can you tell me how that is currently handled and what the developers?
Yes, there's an existing gas pumps located western side. They're to remain. The problem is the tanks itself are where the building is. So these will have to be relocated, and the client has said that he's going to place them over by the travel lift, the underground tanks, and then the lines will be brought out. So the gas pumps will remain where they are today.
Now, one of the questions, I believe, in one of the interview letters was, would fuel be available during construction? If the developer has committed to that, is that correct?
That is correct.
Would you prefer us to go through Mr. Little's letter now or after all of our experts have testified? Or if you have no preference? I'm sorry.
Right now.
Okay. Mr. Becchio, you've had the opportunity to review the review letter provided by Mr. Little. Is that correct?
Yes.
And that review letter was dated December 20th, is that correct?
Yes.
And did you consider each of the questions that were raised by Mr. Little?
Yes.
And I'd like to run through each of the issues. And beginning with page 5, where there's a question about the public restrooms. And for the public's benefit, I'll simply read it. It appears that this required amenity is provided on the ground floor of the hotel on the architectural plan. However, they may need to be relocated to comply with the cultural A zone requirements. Is that something you could use?
Yes.
And did you reach a conclusion that would be
necessary? We have to, the architects answer that.
Oh, okay. We addressed each of the questions. Among Mr. Little's questions that were unique to the engineer was what's the surfacing of the curbs to the sidewalks, what is the landscaping, how is the lighting to be handled, etc. One other thing I'd like to ask you, will there be an area for boat storage when boats are removed from the marina?
Yes, the client has mentioned that the area D is where he'll have some boat storage.
Now, one of the questions Mr. Little mentioned that was unique to you was could curb bumpers be put into the parking area
And is that something that you've reviewed and tried to resolve? Yeah, so we're going to want to do the ag grade markers. It'd be easier for the valets.
And could you just tell the board what the ag grade markers are?
And they're like plastic, insert them into the seashells, and you can mark the parking lots, circle discs.
One other area that came up is the concept of a major development under CAFR. Can you tell the board what that means?
Yes, that means if you have over an acre of disturbance, it is a major development. We agree with Mr. Little, it is over an acre.
And as a consequence of being over an acre, what are the implications with regard to CAFR for that?
It's a more stringent stormwater management review.
That's all the questions I have.
These individual lots as an aggregate total. And your original calculation, I assume your firm did the calculation for the site plan?
Yes.
Came up to 0.99, just under an acre. Mm-hmm. And then our engineer came up with 1.25, that's 0.5% variance. It's a little bit, that's a big number.
Well, we agree, it's all over 1.25.
Okay.
It's probably a little more than that.
I'm just saying that take a look at it. That's a big variance when you came up with that at first. Now we're looking at a 25% increase.
Well, a lot of it was the client had a lot of, for the handicapped parking spots, the pavers. There's a lot more sidewalks, there's more amenities. It just grew, and there was an old number on the plan.
So it's going to go through as a major problem. Okay.
Any other questions?
Concerning the boat storage area that you have moved areas as Area D, there's quite a lot of boats stored in that marina right now through the winter. And is there an estimate of how many boats can be stored in that area for the future? And the second part of the question is it intended that boats will be moved in and out of that area through that area, or are they going to have to access the marina and have boats, you know, we're just driven there through the water?
I think that's a question that Mr. Burke perhaps could answer better, because he operates another marina in the area, and maybe the next meeting I'd ask him to respond to that question.
We address it later, that'd be fine. So, I have a couple of other questions also. So this one's kind of very basic to site development. This has been an operational marina for many, many years, and has a phase one environmental study or a phase two environmental study been completed, and is it part of the information that's available to the public?
Mr. Brenner has done phase one sampled, I'm pretty sure, to make sure that the tanks weren't leaking. But I don't think it requires part of the application, but we can bring it to the next hearing if you wish.
You would.
Yes, the drawings are done professionally and very accurate, but I don't get a real good feeling for how this is going to impact the area
far as emergency vehicle access, you have an 18-foot wide driveway between the restaurant and the hotel. You said, Trump's right.
24.
You said you had emergency vehicles drive around, or did you do that on a scale model?
We have a computer program that you can run the trucks through the building.
The trucks through that scale model?
It's part of the set, similar to the sheets in the back called circulation.
They take into account the different types of apparatus that we may have here?
Yes.
And how much space is between the dock walkway and the hotel for possible fire suppression? How they going to access it from the north side of the hotel? I don't think you can get a fire truck up there, is what I'm asking, for a first aid rig.
Yes, Mr. Vernon had a conversation with a fire marshal, maybe a draft hydrant he's talking about putting back there.
At the very least, I hope. And as well as the parking, you talked about the valet parking, and you're going to stack cars and stack parking. What kind of traveling are you going to have there for emergency? Somebody has a stroke or something.
Yeah, he has to leave a 24-foot wide tile. He has to.
Certainly, it's going to block. As far as the marina building itself, where you have the where the garage, where currently they work on the shop, you have a pool there. The doors open up to the pool. You said you're going to have a snack bar area. Are you going to have any access to that building?
Yeah, they're going to move the doors to the opposite side.
Yes. I have a question. Why are the handicapped parking spaces so far away? I mean, if I'm checking into a hotel and I'm handicapped, I got to walk a pretty far distance to get into the hotel. I mean, there are two underneath, aren't there?
Yes.
Just two?
Yes.
But you have, what, five clustered together over by the swimming pool?
Yes.
I just think they could be better located around the whole project, rather, all at once. And another question I have, is there a buffer zone on lot 7 between the residential area?
Yes, the ordinance says 5 feet.
And you're putting one in?
Yes.
One more question. Is there a bathroom for the pavilion bar? Do you know?
No.
So, people are going to be sitting there all day drinking and there's nowhere to go to the bathroom. They have to walk all the way back to the And one other question. When you drive in the 24-foot wide entrance, there are two bowlers there and it says a pump. What kind of pump is that?
That's the gas pump.
We're going to leave a gas pump right there?
That's the existing one that's going to be removed.
Oh, it's going to be removed. That gas pump?
It's the bollards for the tanks. The tanks are to be moved, not the pumps.
So it will have access to gasoline right there?
No. What we've done is the access to the gasoline is going to be over by the
previously if there would be access to the gas during the building phase. So while we eventually will move that during the construction phase, we may need to leave that there until the hotel is completed.
But once it's completed, it will be removed?
Yes.
And it will be relocated to the, where the travel lift is, the tanks will be in this area.
Is there any thought for your dusk to dawn lighting to possibly dim down so as to not?
Yeah, we've done that with security lighting after a certain hour.
Especially on the north, because a lot of people live over in that area, and even to the east.
That's fair, yeah.
What about balcony lights? Are there lights?
For the hotel?
Yeah.
is the architect.
Streetscape, the bump outs, I know they look aesthetically pleasing, but that's several parking spaces that are getting, you know, any thought to not having them?
That's where the entrance and exit is. That's more of a, it's more of a safety, and, you know, it's an egress egress.
I have another question. The light that you chose, the street light?
It could be a roll, I guess.
But could it be what the master plan selected, which
yeah,
is
that's what
the
they,
rest of the
that's
town?
The intent, yes.
Per ordinance section 167-10H4, it's about the curbing, it mentions that you were going to ask for a waiver
yes.
because of the boats. I have one question though. I accepted that, except as I see the drawing, you're going to put spots over there, correct? Parking spots?
Well,
it's going to be on the western side of Pennsylvania.
Yes.
So how are you going to not have curbs?
Mr. Vernon's he's proposed those. Movable planters, that's what these squares are. You can plant the, there'll be planters in there and lure the curb was our way.
Any ideas that that's what you're going to use your inner storage for the boats?
Yeah. Yeah, we can move the planters out of the way.
I have a question. Of 102 rooms, are there any suites? And what is the occupancy of the rooms and suites?
Save that for the architect.
Separate parking for employment. I think it's inherent in the square footage determination. Be that as it may, I'm familiar with Meredith Betty's Parker's Garage and all the others that have between them, I think, 11 or 12 spaces, except for Blackwell and the Depot.
But those aren't hotels.
No, I recognize that. But we're going to have an excess of parking under your ordinance, not we think we'll mitigate some of the parking deficiencies in that neighborhood. It should be to something like Bird Betty's. I don't have a lot of it, I think of 1,100 out of the cash. So we think we'll mitigate the adverse parking impact.
I don't know what our process is, but I think it's something that should be used.
I have another question about parking. The 29 spaces that you're giving to the Marlin Tuna Club. Why are they getting them, and why isn't it just for the public parking?
Well, it's a seasonal thing. It's a, what was it, May through September? It's six to six, so after 6 p.m.
Well, wait a minute. They get to have an event and use the parking in the parking lot. They have 29 spaces there for 7 months. From May to November, and they're going to have six events, I don't know what it is. That's one a month. I don't know how long an event lasts. Is it a couple days? Is it a week? But I don't understand why we're giving public property for parking to something. Wait a minute. Why don't they put the parking, if they want to give them parking, put it in the parking lot and leave the outside for people in town to use? Because it seems like it's a privilege. They're giving parking to privileged people who belong to a special club. And that's not what the town's about. It's providing parking to everybody, if we can. So if they can park there during the season, because it's not a problem after the season, if they're allowed to park there from 6 in the morning to 6 at night, nobody's going to parole that. So they come in and they park at 5, and they stay there till 11. Also, a lot of people that belong to the Marlin Tuna have boats that they probably keep, I don't know the number, at Morrison's. So they're going to have a parking space inside for their boat, and then they're going to have one outside on the street. It just seems it's a lot of parking for the Marlin Tuna, and I don't know that just doesn't feel right to me. I think you can give them parking because I know they have none, but they've never had none and they've done fine. But it just for some reason, if it's public access property that you're going to put a parking space on, it should be for the public.
48%. If I could just respond to that, that is certainly something that we can explore and hopefully have an answer next week. But the requirement for parking for the Marlin Tuna was something we were asked to do by the governing body, and we were essentially required as part of the redevelopment agreement. So
but you weren't required to put it in that location. They just asked you to provide some parking for them, but not in that exact location.
No, that's correct. One of the reasons we opted for that location is right now, and our traffic expert can talk more about this, that property is owned by Morrison's, and Mr. Vernon, in part is the public, so there's essentially parallel parking now. By Mr. Vernon ceding his portion so it could be perpendicular parking, it created more spaces. So I think that was the thought. I'm not saying that he should change it, but the thought was because we were creating more spaces by seeding the private area, that that would be the area to accommodate the charter fishermen in the Marlin Tuna Club. But we are committed to doing something, so if we have to move somewhere else.
66 people.
I just think if I'm coming into town and I'm looking for a place to park down there, I'm more intimidated about driving through the opening and parking in the parking lot than I am parking on the street. So I would have more of a tendency to want to park on the street than go in the parking lot.
I think that is something before we make it, we need to talk to the consumer club. If I believe I need the applicant.
Just
saying,
Mr. Vernon,
Jim Winkowski, Traffic Jury. We do have a comment about that parking in our report, and we question the ability to actually have the applicant reserve that parking for private use in public right-of-way. Plus, we have a question on how the spaces are set up in both public right-of-way and private property. I think the intent to have the public spaces would be securing the public access even along your property, so your space is fully contained in a public real estate. And then also for restriction on those parking spaces, specifically for the Tuna Club, that would have to be done by the borough or the ordinance, and almost like a permit process, not necessarily by the applicant. They can't restrict public land for the private use.
We certainly agree to that. It is critical, both from the borough's perspective and our perspective, that the ownership of that strip be in one person, because if someone has an accident, they don't want to know who's caused it. But I think that needs more study on our part. I know that's not an answer.
Getting back to the fuel dock, you're going to have the pumps existing where they are now. Did we say where the tanks were going to end up being at the final phase of construction? I believe I read somewhere they're going to be over by the travel lift, correct?
Yes.
A lot of piping, isn't it?
Yeah.
Safety aspect?
Well, it's just access for the fuel truck to get in there.
The public access on the western border. Looking at the plans, I thought it pretty much stopped at where the end of the building stopped. It didn't go all the way to the end of the peninsula. go to the end past the gas pumps then?
No, it goes to the end of the building, like you said.
It stopped at the building, public access. Okay, you were describing the fire pit. Sounded like it was available to the public.
See that one for Chris?
We think that's the only one, right?
If you take a look at the parts provided, I assume that this hotel's gonna generate interest with people that are not part of the hotel, people that are not part of the restaurant, and it's gonna require more parking. If you take a look at the 186 versus a 246, excluding the off-street, that allows 60 parking spots only, in my opinion. All the interest that that spot would generate, what is that gonna do to parking there?
Our goal is to confine the parking to customers. So if some customers, you know, we'll need to have an enforcement mechanism with people out there, but our goal is to confine it to customers, so we think it will be certainly handled for the demand that we create.
Is that dock not public?
I'm sorry?
That dock's public, correct? Bulkhead?
Which dock is it?
That's the one on the western side. That's public. Correct? Yeah, it's public access. How are you gonna control how they park? I mean, you're gonna generate a lot more, my point is, I feel you're gonna generate a lot more interest in 60 parking spots.
We might. I just don't know. But I do know that compared to the street parking generated by every other use, I mean, the catch, for instance, used to have a capacity of 1,100, we're not gonna have the kinds of impact you see from the other uses by any means. But we may generate more than we have the capacity, but because we meet the ordinance, essentially that has to be deemed to be satisfied as a matter of law.
No, please, it's not open to the public yet. When we open it to the public, you will have.
My objection is that this place is provided testimony. I think these are good questions from your board members, but I think they need to be answered by the professionals who have expertise in the areas that they're being asked about. And they shouldn't be answered by the attorney who doesn't have expertise in that field. That's my objection.
Essentially, I'm trying to indicate what the developer will do by studying things. Did I cross the line from the last one? Perhaps. But generally, what I'm reporting to you is what the developer would be committed to do with regard to the questions that you asked.
Any more questions for the board? Okay, thank you.
I could call Greg Rearley, please.
Thank you. Let's see if I could go in. I think it's less of a run this way, isn't it?
Yeah, please sit
but you
down.
Need, you're gonna need
please. Please sit down. You will have your chance.
When?
You will have your chance.
When? I'd like to know when.
After we hear testimony.
So all the witnesses are going to be presented by the
correct.
And then people are going to draw
correct. Thank you. Can I make a wait, Mr. Barely? This is a difficult enough procedure to go through. I don't need anybody in the audience, any cryptic remarks, any clapping, any booing. It shows disrespect to everybody up here, and it shows disrespect for everybody in the audience that's trying to listen and learn. So please, try to be on your best behavior. Now, Mr. Barely.
I do.
And your name and address for the record.
Frank Rearley, landscape architect, address 799-172 Mount Olive.
And I think it's testified here before,
Good evening, Mr. Rearley. You can tell the board where you're employed.
Yep, I'm the principal of CW Door.
And for how long have you
surface long.
CWB architecture, I've been going on 30 years in Naples.
And what's the nature of the business of your company?
We're an architectural firm.
And do you have any license?
Can you go up there?
And will you tell the board, please, what your educational background is?
I have a bachelor of arts in architecture from the University of North Carolina in Charlotte.
The board recognizes you as an expert.
Thank you.
Look at that first.
Mr. Burley, were you the architect that prepared the architectural plans for the application for this board this evening?
I did, yes.
And can you first briefly tell the board what the components of the plan are?
Okay. The buildings that we worked on are mainly for the restaurant building over here on the western edge of the property that's replacing the restaurant that they burned down. The second building would be the hotel building, which lies directly east of the restaurant. The third building will be this building, which is the current ship store. It will become the hotel lobby, front desk, and amenity building. And the other building we worked on is this one up here on the pier, which is on the northwest side of the property, the pavilion block.
And one of the requirements of the redevelopment plan is that we have a hotel with a certain height limitation, is that correct?
That's correct.
And you know what that limitation is or whether it's satisfied?
It is. The hotel, in the agreement, was allowed to go to a roof height of 44 feet, and then an overall height at the elevator tower of 25 feet in height.
And in connection with your design, of the hotel, did you make an assessment as to whether that condition was satisfied?
That condition is satisfied, yes.
Let's start, if we might, with the restaurant and the interior. Just give me a minute to pull it up here. I'm going to show you an exhibit that's on page 12. Will you identify that for the board, please?
Yes. What this is the ground floor of the restaurant portion of the building.
And is this a plan that you prepared?
Yes, it is.
And will you first explain to the board what the nature of the uses are on the ground floor in A
Club? No. Yeah, absolutely. The ground floor, strictly, let me just give you the outline of the building that's here. The lower portion is going to be strictly utilized to gain an entry vestibule into the restaurant, elevators and staircases up to the first floor. And then we're doing two areas below that building, one for the ship store stores, and then an additional larger one for the restaurant stores. And this will strictly be for dry storage for both of those uses on the first floor. This small area here is a small structure that is going to accommodate two restrooms for the public access or public toilet rooms. This line here is the bulkhead along the bayfront, and that's where the public access would be.
And could you tell the board the approximate dimensions of the first floor, please?
The ship storage is approximately 800. The restaurant storage is about 1,500.
In connection with the restaurant, just turn to the next floor, please.
Sorry, I'm going to just address one thing that Mr. Little had. All of the storage area and the vestibule itself will be designed as breakaway construction for that way back to the room. The stairwell and the elevator will be
Could you speak up just a little louder? We're having difficulty on this side.
I'm sorry. Almost have to eat it.
Do you want the witness to repeat what he said?
No, I was talking to Frank, I think.
Oh.
No, I was talking to everybody.
Frank, how will product be moved from the restaurant storage area to the first floor area?
This area back here is a dumbwaiter that we can transfer goods from the storage area up to the back of the kitchen.
Show you exhibit A12, which is sheet R2 of the architectural plan, is that correct?
That's correct.
And can you tell the board first what this is, in very general terms?
This is the first floor of the restaurant, and what is proposed here, I'll give you the outline, again, it's here. That's the total building perimeter. There's an outdoor deck here that will accommodate seating, and some seating against an open air bar that's open to the inside and outside. This portion is the main dining area, and then it opens up to the ship store, which is in the north part of the building. All to the west here is all of the auxiliary spaces, the kitchen area, restrooms, the main lobby, and elevator and staircases.
And the kitchen will be designed to adhere to all fire safety requirements, is that correct?
Yes, it will.
With regard to the dining area, approximately how many tables are envisioned?
We have a count. Give it to you. The first floor of the restaurant accommodates approximately 8,618 square feet. There's an occupant load of 256 in this area, including the outdoor deck and the bar area in seating.
And with regard to A12, which is exhibit R3 of your architectural plan, please tell the board what that is, please.
Yeah, absolutely. This is the plan of the mezzanine. This area is the mezzanine area. It's an area that is between the first floor that I previously showed you and the area of the roof deck, which would be the next level. This whole mezzanine is open to below, so it's a two-story space out here in the dining area. And then this room will accommodate 92 people and has auxiliary bathrooms and exiting from both ends, including the elevator.
And in connection with the mezzanine, access will be, just to point the elevator one more time.
There are stairwells on the north or south side of the building.
And in the left-hand corner of the mezzanine, the L-shaped figure.
This is the bar on the first floor that you see if you're looking down on it. So this slide represents then what is proposed as the roof deck. This area is the roof deck itself. There is a play area here too for outdoor games. Some fire pit areas. We do have a bar proposed. And then a good portion of the rear of this to the west side is going to be a mechanical area to accommodate all the kitchen mechanics and the HVAC equipment for this building. And then we'll have the elevator and the stair vestibule also.
Approximately how many seats are envisioned for the roof deck?
We have shown 200 here, but as noted, 20 for the play area. I think under Mr. Little's letter, the agreement states that it's 200 people maximum, so we will revise this that the roof deck will be no more than 200 people, not seats.
And on the right-hand side, I think that's the easy show lounge. Can you tell us what that is?
Yep, this lounge is actually the connection between the restaurant, this wall, and what will be shown later is the hotel. So there's a breezeway connector. Lounge between the two areas so you can access either the roof deck and or getting down to the restaurant from the hotel.
In connection with the restaurant, could you prepare exterior elevations to show what the exterior of the restaurant will look like?
We did, yes. So what do we propose?
I love before you, this is Exhibit A12, which is R5, the architectural plans. Is this an elevation which you prepared?
Yes, it is.
And this has been marked and then it's a part of A1, I believe. Will you tell the board, please, what is depicted in A12?
Absolutely. This is the south elevation looking from 2nd Street. This is the ground level that is accommodating our vestibule or entry lobby, and then the elevator and stairwells up to the first floor. This level is your first floor restaurant area that's open to the second floor. That's full-size glass and the overhead doors that lead out to the outdoor area. So it's more of an open air type of a restaurant. The whole first floor will be garage doors that open up to the exterior. The design of this is to mimic the old architecture of Beach Haven, and we're tying in that look straight across of the rest of the hotel. We're undulating some of the facade here and doing roofs to break it up, to break down the scale of it, and adding some different textures and materials, again, to break up the facade. As we go to the west on this side of the building, the restaurant then is going to turn into a little bit more of a contemporary look. We're going to run big overhangs on here and fancy brackets, again, to turn this thing more open towards the bay side of it, to give it a lot of interest to that side.
And the materials to be used for the exterior walls, you felt a little bit
better? Yep. What we're proposing is a vinyl shingle for the exterior. We have white trim, we have some fabric awning, we have some metal roofing, we have some board and batten siding also with different areas of this, and some other metal roofing on the feature tower, which is the elevator tower.
At the elevator tower, we tell the board what the height of the elevator tower will be, please.
Yep, the elevator tower, as was granted in the agreement, was 48 feet allowable. We're at 47, 11 and a quarter. And the stair tower was allowed to 41 feet, which is this portion, and we're at 40 feet 11.
And the railing to the roof deck, how high does that go?
That is at 35 feet and conforms to the height of the ordinance.
I'd ask you to go up for A12 with evidence, please. I guess that would be A12A. Okay. This is the west restaurant elevation, is that correct?
This is the western elevation or bay side of the restaurant. What I mentioned previously is these are all garage doors that will open up to the exterior. We'll have railings across the opening so that it'll be a fully open area. Restaurant bar, bar area being at this end, and that deck that was noted before is just in this area. We have full height glass on the second floor. Again, it's a full two-story room, so there'll be a lot of light there coming into the side of it. Each one of these areas will have a big bracket. There'll be a big overhang that's shown here on the side elevation, running fully across the back. And then the roof deck will just be open glass railing. This is representative of that elevator tower and the stairwell to the left side of the roof deck.
Really, you were also the architect who designed the hotel, is that correct?
That's correct, yes.
And I show you again with the map of A12 show ready for evidence.
Absolutely. the previous building I mentioned is the restaurant, which is here. This is a breezeway that was previously mentioned by the engineer that separates these two buildings. The hotel runs in from this point to this point, which is all east of the restaurant, but running west to east. It's set up basically in two buildings. connects them in between, again, breaking that scale of it along Second Street that we have a big indent. And along with undulating the whole facade on both sides. The ground floor is going to be, again, utilized strictly for this lounge and entry on the east side of the structure, with this long covered porch. And then the main stair and elevators are here. We have some auxiliary spaces like the sprinkler room. And then to the rear of that is that marina facilities that we were talking about previously with the bathrooms and showers for the marina patrons. The lounge is just strictly to say we're going to meet for dinner or something like that. There might be some couches and chairs, you know, just for waiting.
Mr. Langdon, can you use the microphone?
I'm sorry, you indicated, you started to point out what was to the west of the lounge area.
To the west of the lounge area then, as was previously noted by the engineer, also this whole area below on the ground floor is parking, or some of the parking for the hotel, with the entry here and the exit over here. And then the upper floor is the first floor above grade, would be accommodating of all of the hotel units. And then there are some auxiliary spaces up there also. They have some mechanical rooms and some housekeeping rooms that are provided on both floors. And they'll run from, well, on both sides, on the north side and the south side, with a center hall type setup, the rooms off of that.
And approximately how many rooms will be on that first floor?
On that floor, there's 33, I think. We have 37 units on this first floor. On this floor, let me give you that count now. There's 33 units on the second floor, and there's 32 units on the third floor, for a total of 102 units.
You pointed out earlier some ancillary space that gets to be used for maids, is that correct? Or?
That's correct. There'll be some housekeeping areas, and there'll be some mechanical areas that we need for electrical panels and things like that. So similar to the first floor, the second floor is set up again with the center hall.
This is H2 of A12, which you guys already marked. Please describe what's shown on the second floor, if you will.
Yep. Again, there's a center hall that's typical on both the first, second and third floors, with the rooms on the north and south of those corridors. There is a deck on the east side of the building on all three floors. That will show on the elevations. And again, we have some ancillary spaces for the housekeeping and mechanical spaces. And then the exiting and elevators. This is that connector, which is between the two buildings that I was talking about, with the, you know, break in that length of building.
And we're finally in regard to the ship store.
The ship store is in the restaurant. The roof plan is a roof plan. This is that section of the roof that exceeds or
to signage, did you prepare a plan which depicts the signs proposed for the site?
We did, yes.
And I'll show you again BD12. Can you tell the board what that is?
Yep, but these are the number of signs that are throughout the site and located on the buildings that are proposed for, I guess, buildings and site. What we have are a number of them. There's four similar to this.
They should be top left-hand corner.
Yep, top left-hand corner. It says Hotel Marina. These are typical of an old pier-style signage with a large pilaster and siding and some panelized column at the top of it. These would be located as part of the engineer's site plan. And identify major areas.
That would be on Pennsylvania Street?
The Marina is, I believe, at the end of 3rd Street, facing into the parking lot.
Then to the right, could you describe that sign to the board, please?
This one, Maritime Pier. I believe that one is set out at the end of the pier facing the bay and the pavilion.
And the decoration at that time is substantially similar to the one you just previously described?
Yes, it is. All four of these are very similar.
And the restaurant building sign, where will that be located?
This restaurant building sign is a building-mounted sign. It's shown on the elevations that we had shown on the previous two pages of the restaurant. There'll be building-mounted up near the height of the roof deck on both the south and the west side.
And the restaurant sign to the left?
Yep, this one is a curve. It's built into the canopy above the entrance of the restaurant. This hotel sign is an old-style side-mounted hotel sign that's going to be mounted against the southeast corner of the hotel building. And this is the hotel sign over the entry of the main entry of the lower floor of the hotel.
And just for record purposes, you're pointing to the sign at the building scale, correct?
The building sign.
Yeah, building sign, sorry. I neglected to ask you the dimensions of the sign. Would you please go back to the top left-hand corner and tell us roughly what the dimensions are?
Okay, the Hotel and Marina sign, this one is, it says Pennsylvania Street sign. That sign is 34 feet wide in the opening, and it'll be 38 feet wide in totality. The top of the sign itself is 27 foot 8 inches. Clearance below is about 20 feet. Maritime Pier, which is located out on the peninsula, is going to be the same height, 27.5. And the total width on that sign is 26 feet wide. The two smaller ones that are on there, the Second Street sign that says Sport Fishing Charters, that sign will be 10 feet wide and 12 foot 3.5 inches tall. And the identical sign that says restaurant directly next to it on that sheet, identified as restaurant sign, will be 10 feet wide, also about 12 foot 3.5 inches high. The two individual lettered signs for the building mounted signs for the restaurant will be 2 foot 10 3/4 inches high, and the total run on those will be 21.5 feet wide. The restaurant sign over the entrance that I mentioned is in that panelized area above the front door is going to be 2 foot 4 inches high and 9 foot 8 1/4 inches wide. The hotel building mounted sign that I said would be over the entranceway is 1.5 foot high by 7 foot 8 3/4 inches wide. And then that vertical mounted building sign for the hotel is 12 feet high by 2 feet wide.
Thank you. Does the term breakaway wall have a meaning to those in your field?
Yes, it does.
And can you tell the board what that is, please?
You know, what a breakaway wall will do is any areas located below a required either base flood or design flood elevation as required to actually break away is designed to resist 20 pounds or less in force under a water or wave condition to break away.
Now, have you incorporated breakaway walls in your design of this building, of any of these buildings?
Yes, we did. We designed breakaway walls throughout the whole hotel area and the restaurant area. The whole areas below those, other than those that I mentioned that would be floodproof, would be a breakaway construction.
Now, heating and cooling, how's that going to be handled in each of these buildings?
As I mentioned, we have a mechanical area, the rooftop area of the restaurant that will handle the HVAC and any other mechanicals required for the kitchen. In the hotel, everything will be in the wall pack. There'll be no roof-mounted mechanical on top of that roof that would further exceed the height.
And did you give consideration to fire protection techniques, fire safety?
We did in the early stage on this, yes. All the buildings will meet the current fire codes, and all of the buildings will be sprinkled.
And will they be wet sprinklers or dry sprinklers?
That will be determined.
Okay.
Probably a mix.
Now, you have the opportunity to review the comment letter from Mr. Little, did you not?
Yes, I did.
And a number of those comments were addressed to architectural issues, is that correct?
They were, yes. And I believe we had addressed them most with the revision in the second submission of the plans. One was about the occupancy of the roof that we had just testified to, and that would be limited to the 200. We addressed the issue of the concerns of the walls below the base flood elevation for the permanent areas, the restrooms and the window.
Yeah, on page 5, Mr. Little inquires as to whether the public restrooms meet the cultural aid requirements, is that correct?
That's correct.
And how are we dealing with that?
As I previously testified, that those would be built as flood-proof structures, and we have discussed this with our structural engineer, and our structural engineer can design those walls to resist the wave action and height required.
And in addition, there was an inquiry about how you handle signage for handicapped parking, is that correct?
Yeah, that's not me, that was the engineer. And I think he'll provide that detail on his comments, I think is what that comes down to.
Mr. Little in item 7B inquired as to where the mechanical equipment will be located for the front desk of the marina.
Well, this is the next building that I think we should probably show, which is the current marina store that is going to be the new hotel lobby and reception building.
Mr. Little also inquired as to whether it be string lighting on the rooftop deck, comment 9C.
Yes, we had added a note to our drawings on the revision that we had submitted that there were going to be string lights on the roof as well as proposed, and they would just be post-mounted at approximately 8 or 9 feet off the surface of the deck.
Can you please speak up? I can't hear what you said about the lighting on the deck.
Okay. The lighting on the deck is what we had proposed, the string lighting, and that they would be post-mounted at approximately 8 or 9 feet off the deck. I don't have a time limit on that lighting.
There's no public comment. You'll have your chance.
Maybe he's not describing the lighting. Lighting on a 48-foot building is huge in that area.
Just wait till you have your chance to come up and express your feelings.
So I have a question about the string lighting myself. You're saying they're going to be mounted on 8-foot posts above the deck. So is that going to exceed the height limit you're approved for?
That would exceed the height limit.
You're not going to be doing string lighting on 8-foot posts.
Okay. Okay. Whatever the board wishes.
No, that's good.
Great, A12, L1 of A12, become a board of that.
Yep, this is the existing Marina store. It's currently sitting on the corner of Pennsylvania and Second. Basically, what we're doing is remodeling this building. We're adding this covered porch that's wrapping around a little bit more to the deck in the back to be able to get handicap access through a ramp, and some stairs that will face onto Pennsylvania, and then some stairs that will exit off the back, you know, so that we can get to the hotel lobby. The only addition we're doing here is an elevator and elevator equipment room to the rear of the structure, in addition to the covered porches to dress up the facade of the building. Some of the interior spaces that we're just going to reuse, we're going to create some studies. This is the main lobby area for checking in, for their check-in desk, and then we're going to create some offices to the rear of that space. Second floor of this, currently what we're looking at is that...
For record purposes, you're referring to exhibit L2, which is going to be even clearer, correct?
It is, yes.
Describe that to
me. Okay. So the second floor of this, what we're proposing is, again, reutilizing the space that is up there and turning one into a fitness space. A new exit stair out the back and the elevator to the second floor. The front of this space would be a flex space that's to be determined yet whether or not there's a craft space or a massage or something else that can be utilized in that area. They lead off to some existing decking that we're going to cover so that we can create some interest to the facade of the building.
Okay, we held exhibit L3 or sheet L3 of A12. Application.
This is, yes. This is the east elevation or the face facing Pennsylvania Avenue. And again, it's depicting that covered porch that we're adding with some metal roofing, the new railings that we're going to propose on there, and some brickwork along the face of it. We would be re-siding the bottom with clapboard style siding and then shingle style siding on the upper portion of the building. Again, we're going to do some metal accents on the roofs that we bump out for the covered porches, both on the north, south, and this one on the east side.
And the material for the exterior, what will that be made of?
Yep, we're the same as the hotel and the restaurant. We're looking at a vinyl here and probably something like a hardy clapboard on the bottom.
Exhibit L4, excuse me, sheet L4 of Exhibit A12, is that something that you prepared?
Yes, it is.
And what is that?
This is the facade on 2nd Street of, again, the reconstruction, I'm sorry, the remodeling of the current Marina store into the hotel lobby. And again, the same treatments that I just mentioned for the east facade would be applied to the south facade. And again, the porch is going to add some interest to the face of this and the new gable on it. And some board and batten siding and changes with metal roofing and asphalt roofing. So it gives the building some interest.
So quick question.
And again, all of them are designed to, you know, coordinate with one another and give that style of architecture.
So quick question. Based on the amount of improvement you're making to this building, is that going to be considered a substantial improvement and then have to meet the limited wave action zone?
Yes. We looked at that question, and at this point, we feel that we're not going to exceed that number and not have to be required.
That would be something to bring up at the time of building if we get that far.
Yes.
Are you raising that building?
No, we're not. That was a question that Mr. Lewis was just asking about, whether or not it was a substantial improvement or not that would require it to be raised. Mechanical equipment on this one, again, is going to be located within the building. Nothing roof-mounted on it to, again, impede on any of the other height. We did revise the drawing to show the AC compressors out in the side yard behind, just to the north of the rear stair.
A quick L5 of A12, again, is that an exhibit
Yes, it is.
And what does that show?
This shows the western facade of that marina building, or marina hotel lobby. I don't want to get redundant.
Right.
I'm sure we're getting clarity here about siding, but it's all going to match around the three sides, the four sides of the building.
If you have the pavilion, let's see it.
We got the pavilion.
It does say it on the hard copy, I don't know what happened here.
This basically is just an open air structure. It'll open on three sides. We're running three columns up to support the flat roof structure so that we can form a diamond for that area. We're going to do some brick face on it. Again, all of this will be breakaway construction since this is just an open air structure. Everything in here will be breakaway. The use of this currently was proposed as being a bit of everything, snack bar, bar, paid area for the people coming in from the public area, can buy bunker and crab off of the docks and stuff. So it's kind of a multi-use building.
Mr. Brimley, I think in the course of your testimony, you addressed most of Mr. Little's comments. The only one this was dealing with handicaps on it. We did not show handicaps.
I did not know, and I think that will be on the engineer's plan. He'll include those
it was our
details. So the overall site then is...
this is exhibit A7. Before you testify, I'm sure you can tell us what this exhibit shows, if you would.
Yep, this is an aerial view of the total site, showing all the buildings, all the parking areas, and the marina itself.
And is this an exhibit that you prepared?
I did not. We had a sub-consultant prepare this document.
And does it
accurately...
Does it accurately represent what's proposed for the site?
Yes, it does.
Yeah, I'd like to offer this as exhibit A7, Mr. Shin. Thank you. And we describe what A7 is. That's wrong as a
this, matter. I don't know if you heard what I said. I said this was done by a sub-consultant that was hired by us and was prepared based on our drawings.
In order for a image depiction to come in, all the law requires is testimony that the image accurately represents what the court so the person who prepared it does not have to testify about photographs, images, or anything of that nature. You explain to the board what A7 shows, please.
Absolutely. And it's an aerial view showing the total site. The buildings that we're dealing with architecturally would be the existing marina building that we're remodeling, the current maintenance building, and then the hotel building down 2nd Street, and then the restaurant on the west end of the building. That pavilion that we had just shown is here, and then it depicts the parking areas
are you under your supervision?
Yes, I am.
And what does this exhibit show?
This is looking at the main entry, or hotel entry lobby, looking towards the southwest, northwest. These are the porches that I had mentioned that we're adding to this building, along with the covered porches on the upper floor, and then dressing up of the exterior of that building.
And this refers to a fitness center. We tell the board where that is, please.
Yep, that's on the second floor where these Bermuda shutters are proposed on the back side of the building.
And the approximate size of that fitness center, please?
It's probably in the neighborhood of 1,000 to 1,200 square feet.
This is A9. Again, is this an exhibit prepared by you or under your supervision?
Yes, it is.
And can you tell the board what this represents?
Absolutely. This is the resultant park space between the hotel, the three-story hotel here, and the hotel lobby on the east side. So this is that landscaped area that the engineer talked about that gives both access to the marina and access from the lobby through to the hotel.
To the rear of the image.
Yep, straight through the back there. This is the maintenance building, that snack bar at the edge of the maintenance building, and then the pool amenity, which would be to the north of that park.
I'd like to offer this as evidence as well. A9.
Again, that's that sign that we presented earlier. Yes, it is.
And how to explain how this exhibit came to be prepared.
Yep, well, this is looking back at the restaurant and the hotel from the public parking area, and we are looking towards the northeast. Again, this is that offset or access area to the marina where deliveries and the loading is, and then this area is the hotel. That's the break in between the two buildings that I had mentioned previously, that it gives it a broken appearance and shows how the facade is undulated all the way down with different roof types and styles and offset balconies and materials.
Does this exhibit accurately depict the architectural plans which you drew?
Yes, they do.
And the prior exhibits that were marked as elevations, do they accurately depict the architectural plans which you drew?
They do.
A11, is this an exhibit prepared by you or under your supervision?
Yes, it is.
And does this accurately depict what it purports to show?
Yes, it does. This is the restaurant looking from an aerial of the west side, looking again a little bit more east. This shows that big overhang with the bracketing on there, the two-story glass. These are all of the garage doors that open this side to the bar and then this side just to the dining area and the store. This is that enclosure for the storage, and then the open area below just shows that, again, public access walkway here, and then an outdoor dining deck. It also depicts that bar that we had mentioned previously on the roof, and then that seating that was proposed with the play area on the north end of the roof deck.
And just to give the board some perspective, the street on the right-hand side of the exhibit, what street is that?
That's 2nd Street, and this is the public parking area.
We have one more exhibit, if you would. Sure.
You're the best, thank you. Sure thing. This is an aerial view from flying out the bay. This shows again the totality of the site with the
restaurant in the foreground, to the right side, the break in the building, and then the hotel building here. To the east of that is the park, and then the hotel lobby, the maintenance building, adjacent to that with the pool area. And as you come around to that peninsula, this would be the pavilion bar.
And is this anything different prepared by you or under your supervision?
Yes, it is.
And does it accurately depict what it purports to show?
Yes, it does.
Madam Chairman, I don't have any other questions to this witness.
Okay.
Thank you.
I'll open it to the board now. Does anybody on the board have questions for the architect?
The rooftop decks, the restaurant. 200 people there. 256 on the first floor. Obviously, they're going to spill out the street, but they still have to go downstairs. 92 in the mid-level. One set of stairs, did I say that correctly?
No, there are two sets of stairs. There's one set on the north side of the building, and then there's one on the south side of the building.
Nothing exterior?
No, the one exit off the north side is an exterior stairway. That's the second exit.
I know there's plans, but if you follow and you get egress to the proper numbers, it's a scary thought.
You'd be surprised what two exits will carry. It is ridiculous. About 500 people per. But yes, the exiting insurance will accommodate all of the occupants of this building.
Okay, I have some questions. Just out of curiosity, the hotel section is 44 feet high, and the elevator tower is 45.9. But the elevator tower goes up to 48. Why does that have to be so much taller? Why does it have to be that tall? That's one question.
Okay.
Then I read, I think on page 5 of the plan, something about that the finished floor of the entry is below the flood hazard area elevation. Why would you do that?
Of which building you're talking about?
The restaurant, I believe.
Yeah, the restaurant.
Is it not? Is it below the flood elevation?
Yeah, the restaurant and the hotel lobby are both below flood elevation. Mm-hmm. They allow entrances, storage, and garages below flood elevation. So it's not that it's not allowed.
Okay. Are there any kitchens in any of the bedrooms?
There are not, no.
Okay. What are the overall sizes, the average size of the bedroom?
Each unit is approximately 14 foot center to center, and they average between 24 and 28 feet in depth.
Okay. Are there any apartments?
No apartments.
So
you mean apartments by what number of bedrooms, living room, kitchen, and all of that?
Right.
No.
So there wouldn't be any short-term rentals, like of 1 to 3 months? Somebody couldn't, or could they, come in, it wouldn't have?
I would doubt that, one, that they would want that type of person in there, but no, there wouldn't be any kitchen facility for them.
Okay. How many?
Which is a requirement for a residence.
How many bars are on this site? Three? You've got the one in the restaurant.
There's one in the restaurant.
The one in the pavilion bar.
One at the roof. The pavilion bar and
pool?
I don't believe that that is, but I'm not certain. Chris will have to answer that one. I'm not certain that the pool snack bar.
Okay. The bait shops. There are two bait shops?
There are two areas that you can probably buy bait, yes.
One is in the ship store.
Ship store, and then the pavilion.
So you're going to have, be selling drinks and selling bait at the same pavilion bar, is that?
It's a multi-purpose facility, yeah. It's not strictly a bar, tiki hut type bar to sit at and drink all day.
It's not.
It's a multi-purpose bar. Yeah.
And you didn't, again, you did not feel the necessity for a bathroom at the tiki bar, or the pavilion bar?
I did not. It's only kind of selling snacks. It's like a concession to me.
so it doesn't have a requirement for a bathroom like a building does, and there's other facilities on the site.
Are you qualified to say what the play area on the roof deck is going to be used for?
There's other facilities, it's got the bocce ball and the cornhole and things like that.
There's one of those outside fireplaces, those gas fireplaces?
Yes.
There's one of those up there too?
Yes, there were two proposed, they show on the plan.
Okay. What is the color of the roof?
Well, what is shown or depicted on there is like a driftwood, a dark driftwood color.
And metal?
It's an asphalt roof, where it's depicted as asphalt.
And what is the metal color?
That's to be determined.
By when?
By the time the Architectural Review Committee and I finalize all of those materials. We've been working with them on those materials. They have not suggested a color or fix a color at this time.
Well, I personally would like, and I'm going to put in my 2 cents, I personally would like to see something very classic and understated in Beach Haven. I'm not particularly fond of light, bright blue like you did in Ship Bottom, because we're not Ship Bottom. So I just think something more classic is better looking and some bright color. Well, I think all of that is going to be dated in 10 years.
You would certainly take that into suggestion, yes.
Thank you. Anybody else have any questions? Oh, Vance?
Sorry, I had to move down here because I couldn't hear up there. Basically, I have a couple questions. The active bar on the west side, on the north side, one of my concerns is we don't want to turn it into something like the boathouse down on the causeway. But I do think it would be nice. I don't want to see a porta potty there. Okay? So I mean I think if that happened, you know, I don't want it to be a boathouse. So probably by not having a bathroom there, it won't attract too many people standing around the bar drinking for long periods of time. But one of my questions is, are there designated places on the property where people can drink versus not drink?
Drink and not drink? The designated bars that were just mentioned. There's
like a hidden drink in the bars, right?
There's a bar at the restaurant, and there's a bar on the roof of the restaurant that the public can go to. I'm assuming and I probably should leave this for Chris to answer whether or not the Mill Surf Liquor at the pool.
Uh-huh.
And this one, I'm certain, would be open to the public because it's more of a public thing. It's a snack bar for them, it's a bait shop for them, and a bar. I don't think it's going to be a TV bar. Chris can answer that for you.
Okay. I had a couple other questions, but...
The restroom facility there that I feel that we might have an issue with is with the DDP doing that one below flood. We've had preliminary meetings with them about relocating the other marina facilities under the building. We're hoping the public bathroom can be under there also for the DEP in this pavilion. I'm not certain we can do that. It would probably have to be a raised structure.
Mm-hmm. Well, one of the other things I'm concerned about, when we approved the 450 seat restaurant and the 200 people in the deck, my impression was that the deck was sort of a holding area for the restaurant people waiting. I assume that food wasn't going to be served on the rooftop. Is there any, do you know, is that, I don't know if that comes to this part? Or?
Yeah, I'm going to leave Chris to answer that one.
Okay.
Yeah, whether it's similar to what he currently uses, does or not, I'll leave that to him to answer.
Okay. All right.
That is the main check-in,
main check-in.
Lobby.
Well, right. What do you have for parking in and out, coming and going, people stopping, coming in, checking, and then away they go again, or how does that work?
I think the engineer addressed that. I'll leave that to the engineer, how that circulation works. There's a couple of ways to pull in, depending on how you're coming, whether or not you're stopping on Pennsylvania to get out and come out. We utilize the parallel parking if that's going to be provided to the front. You'll check in, and then you'll go to the parking lot and or use the valet to park.
There will be designated areas for the people coming in to check in.
We have discussed that, yes.
Have you ever come up with a total number occupancy license?
Well, the hotel is designated as per the agreement that there be no more than 400 seats in the restaurant and 200 seats on the roof. And we were below that in our proposal.
Hotel.
The hotel. Well, the occupancy is the number of rooms. I can give you the number of beds, if that's the question.
That would be a good start.
There's, in the mix of rooms and suites, there's 180 beds.
180 beds?
Yes. That's a mix of king rooms, queen rooms, and double queen rooms, and then the suite rooms.
Are your signs lit? Do they light up? Are your signage, the signs that you showed, are they lit up?
They will be lit up, yes.
And they follow our code for that?
They will.
I mean, I went over the plans pretty well, and I'm just questioning. I know you have some rooms in the lobby, the old ship store. Are you having meeting rooms for business groups and that sort of thing? Will that be in that building? Say if somebody wanted to come down in the winter and bring a business a group down, and they wanted to have a meeting, will that be
in the marine? I mean the. Hotel lobby, the old ship store? No.
No.
No, that's just strictly the hotel lobby and the amenities.
Are there any meeting rooms anywhere in this hotel?
No, the only place I think that could be utilized for that would be the mezzanine.
The what room?
The mezzanine in the restaurant.
Oh, okay.
And or the restaurant itself, I'm assuming.
So all the food on the mezzanine has to come up in that elevator from the kitchen below, correct?
Yes.
Yes, okay.
Or the dumbwaiter. The dumbwaiter does go to that floor from the kitchen.
Okay, that's what I mean, the one over in the corner, right?
Yes.
Okay.
The area between the restaurant and the hotel, the breezeway, is that going to be fenced off so people can see through, or block us so they can't see through?
No, that's going to be open.
Yeah, I'm just going to switch over for a few minutes.
And I should mention about that too, because I think the one question Mr. Little had was about the enclosure around the hotel. They look like those garage doors are glass. They are garage doors, but they're going to be left open seasonally. So the whole lot of that hotel will be open, clear through to the marina, so that you'll see through, there'll be light there coming through. So everywhere you're walking down that road, you're going to see through the marina.
We don't have to double it after, do we?
Another question. In your design of the west side of the hotel, do you take into account the setting of the sun? There's an awful lot of
glass. We will on the glass, yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. They've got to give it to me.
So what do you do, put special glass? So,
yes.
All the questions the board has. I was asked by one of the board members or the witness was, will there be lights on the balcony? So I neglected to ask that question.
Right outside of the other ones, which is Juliet balconies with doors.
else have any questions on the board? No. I can't see them. No. All right, thank you very much.
Good evening, James Raven, co-counsel for the applicant. At this time, we'll call Elizabeth Dolan.
Do you swear or affirm that testimony about the truth?
Yes, I do.
And your name and credentials, correct?
Elizabeth Dolan, D-O-L-A-N, Dolan and Dean Consulting Engineers, 181 West High Street in Somerville, New Jersey.
Okay, Mrs. Dolan, would you briefly describe your employment history?
Yes, for almost 34 years, I focused in the area of traffic and transportation engineering. I have a Bachelor of Science degree in civil engineering from Rutgers. I'm a licensed professional engineer registered in New Jersey, New York, Pennsylvania, and Delaware. The focus of my experience has been on the preparation of traffic impact studies, parking studies, engine DOT applications. I'm regularly testifying before planning and zoning boards throughout the state. I've appeared in over 250 municipalities in New Jersey. I've also had the opportunity to review traffic and parking and DOT access aspects of applications on behalf of planning and zoning boards in New Jersey.
And you're a licensed professional engineer, is that correct?
That's correct.
And that's in the state of New Jersey?
In New Jersey, as well as Pennsylvania, Delaware, and New York.
And you said you've testified before a number of boards in Ocean County?
I have testified in Chapada, Stafford, Brick, Toms River, Manchester, Plumstead, to name a few, in Ocean County. But overall, throughout New Jersey, I've testified and been accepted as an expert in traffic in over 250 municipalities.
Thank you. I'd like to ask the board to accept Ms. Dolan's qualifications.
Yes, we accept her.
Thank you. But before we get into your report, Ms. Dolan, would you explain to the board a little bit what goes into a traffic study generally?
Certainly. A typical traffic study will look at the peak periods when a new development is going to generate the most traffic. Typically, we look at weekday mornings, weekday evenings, and midday Saturdays. Those are the traditional time periods when street traffic is highest, and we test the ability of the surrounding roadway system to accommodate traffic during those periods. So a typical traffic study originates with traffic studies performed at nearby intersections and then a projection of future traffic volumes for the development in question, and then an evaluation of what we call the future build traffic volumes. We look at the traffic volumes before and after the development, and we run a series of analyses to test the traffic impact and determine if roadway improvements are needed, if the access is going to adequately function, and so those are the basic characteristics of a traffic impact study.
Thank you. And as part of this application, we submitted a report that you prepared that was originally dated November 13th and revised December 11th, 2019. Is that correct?
That is correct.
And who prepared that report?
I prepared the majority of it. It was prepared under my supervision.
Thank you. And I guess for the record, I'd like to mark the traffic report as Exhibit 815. And I'm just pulling up Exhibit A3 so that you can refer to that if you need to, which shows the overall site. Bear with me a moment. With regard to the report that you did prepare, explain to the board, if you would, what went into that report.
Certainly. We are just referring to A3, which is up on the screen. We looked at the roadway system
adjacent to or nearby the subject property. And of course, Bay Avenue is the primary road through through the island, which would provide primary access to the site. As all of the exhibits you've seen tonight, including A3, have shown, Pennsylvania Avenue immediately abuts the property to the east. And between Pennsylvania Avenue and Bay Avenue is Delaware Avenue, another north-south roadway. We are intersected by 3rd Street, and then just south of 3rd Street is 2nd Street. So the traffic study looked at Delaware Avenue at 2nd and 3rd Street as being the primary test for the impact assessment, because we know the constraints of Bay Avenue during the time period, and that's not going to change. So the real test is what happens at the Delaware Avenue intersections before and after site traffic. As I said, a typical traffic study would look at weekday morning, weekday evening, and midday Saturday periods. But for this, recognizing we're at the beach, we looked at several different time periods. When we first started this traffic study, it was back in 2018. So we first performed traffic counts, was in September 2018, on the weekday morning evenings when school was in session. So this was in September of 2018, from 7 to 9 and 4 to 6 at Bay Avenue and 2nd Street. And things got quiet with the project for a while, but then in May we went back, May of 2019, and we counted from 7 to 9 and from 4 to 6:30 at Bay Avenue and 3rd, Delaware and 2nd, Delaware and 3rd. And then in the summer of 2019, in August, we did a series of traffic counts at a variety of different time periods, including Friday evenings from 5 to 8, people are coming down for the weekend, Saturday morning from 8 to 11, Saturday afternoons and midday, generally from 11 to 2, and then from 2 to 7 p.m., and on Sunday evenings from 3 to 6. And these time frames were taken, traffic counts were taken during these periods because they're busy dining hours, and we know that the area around the subject property has other restaurants, and so there's activity in the area. And people are coming and going for the weekend, as well as the traditional weekday morning and evening periods when school's in session. So we had a whole series of traffic counts. Those traffic counts were performed. They're called manual turning movement counts, where we count the left turns, the through volumes, and right turns on all intersection approaches at these different intersections and during the different times. As I said, there are 7 different peak periods that we studied. All of them were performed at the Delaware Avenue intersections with 2nd and 3rd, and then the other locations, we didn't get them all during all periods, but we have a very fair sampling of at least 5 peak periods at each of the intersections. So there's 6 intersections and a total of 7 periods.
And which intersections were those that were studied?
Sure. Bay Avenue at 2nd, Bay Avenue at 3rd, Delaware and 2nd, Delaware and 3rd, Pennsylvania and 2nd, Pennsylvania and 3rd. We didn't focus too much on the Pennsylvania intersections because Pennsylvania is a dead end to the north, and we're going to have a lot more activity up and down Delaware, and that's where Delaware gives us a really good picture of the before and after before and after site generated traffic is added. So manual turning movement counts were performed over these different hours, and then we isolate the busiest traffic volume hour. So we take the highest 4 15 minute consecutive traffic counts, and that becomes a peak hour. So we isolated the weekday morning peak hour, weekday evening peak hour, the Friday evening peak hour, Saturday morning peak hour, midday Saturday hour, Saturday evening and Sunday evening at each of the study intersections. And that becomes our existing traffic conditions, existing traffic volume conditions. And we're looking at, again, peak hours because during the other hours, traffic on the roadway system is lower.
Quick question for you.
Sure.
The date, I'm sorry, you stated was May 19th?
Oh, I have a whole bunch of dates. Thursday, September 20, 2018. Wednesday, September 19, 2018. Thursday, May 2nd, 2019. Saturday, May 4th, 2019. Tuesday, June 11th, 2019. Then we have Fridays, August 9th, 2019, August 16th, 2019. Saturday, August 10th, 2019. And Sunday, August 11 and August
18, 2019. And those times are contained within page 8, a table on page 8 of your report, is that correct?
That's right, it's table 2 on page 8. So once the existing conditions are established in the traffic study, we then have to forecast to the future. And the first thing we do is we use a growth rate compounded over a 2-year build-out, and the growth rate is derived from DOT's database. And so it was a 1.5 for local roads and 1% per year for Bay Avenue. And that was applied over 2 years to account for other things that are happening that might cause traffic to increase aside from this specific development. But then we have to make estimates of how much traffic's going to enter and exit the subject area as a result of the new hotel and restaurant. And to do that, we use data that's published by the Institute of Transportation Engineers in a manual. It's called the Trip Generation Manual. And it's a publication that contains trip rates, hourly trip rates, based on the number of hotel rooms, the building area of a restaurant, if you were doing residential, it would be the number of units, commercial space, the amount of commercial space. And so these rates are developed from traffic engineers counting similar uses, submitting the data to the ITE, and they compile all of this for use in estimating how much peak hour traffic will be generated by a particular use. And as the board's traffic engineer had pointed out, there's a couple of different hotel designations in this ITE trip generation manual. We selected the one that seemed to be most appropriate based on what's actually proposed here, and as you've heard, it's a 102-room hotel. There's not a restaurant in it. There's not convention facilities or meeting rooms in it. It's a hotel. And when we looked at the ITE's data, we estimated for the hotel 40 weekday morning peak hour trips, 38 weekday evening peak hour trips. And then for all of the peak seasonal, Friday evening, Sunday evening, and all day Saturday, the different peak hours that we're looking at, 48 trips. That's a total of the inbound and outbound. And Mr. Winkowski from CME had asked, well, what if you use some of the others, some of the other ITE hotel numbers? And I came up with an estimate of anywhere between 8 and 27 additional peak hour trips that might be generated if you did use those. That's not a number that would significantly change the results of the study, but that was something that was we were asked to look at and is included in our revised study. For the restaurant, we're estimating 100 morning peak hour trips, 170 weekday evening peak hour trips, and then 200 trips for all of those other peak seasonal summertime hours that we're looking at, Friday evening, Saturday morning, midday evening, and Sunday evening. So that's separate trip generation for the two uses based on standalone hotel, standalone restaurant, and not taking any credit for people who are maybe staying at the hotel and using the restaurant. And the ITE guidelines have trip credits that are applicable, but we didn't use those. We took no credit for shared activity between these two uses, or the marina for that matter. And we also didn't take any credit for people who might bike or walk to the area or use Uber or Lyft or LB Transit. So it's a very fair projection without credits for some of the real things that will likely be happening, most specifically someone who's staying at the hotel and then using the restaurant.
The report references level of service rating. Could you just define to the board what that means?
Sure, and that's the next step, is as we estimate the traffic that's associated with these new uses, we then add that on to the background traffic that we counted and expanded for area development and other things that might change traffic volumes. So we have a set of traffic volumes for the future without the hotel and the restaurant, and with the hotel and the restaurant. And so those are our no building build conditions. And it's traffic volume projections at our different study locations. And then we run the level of service analysis. And this is a means of grading how well intersection movements operate. And it's a lot like your grades at school, A through F. If you're at A and B, there's little or no delay, you can get through an intersection pretty easily. When you're down at level of service E, well, that's what you're seeing on Bay Avenue during the busy summer on a Saturday, and level F. There's just not enough capacity to accommodate the traffic volume. So we run this level of service analysis for the no build and build volumes, and there's a lot of number crunching because it's 7 peak hours and a bunch of different intersections. So I'll start with Bay Avenue and 3rd, which is the only signalized intersection in our study. And of course, recognizing the constraints on a Saturday, we calculate the levels of service, but they're really calculating what's getting through the intersection. But for the no build to build conditions in a weekday morning, there's no changes except for the northbound left goes from an A to a B. Weekday evening, the eastbound movement goes from a C to a D. And it's an added 1.5 seconds of added delay. So it's not that much, but that's the change. So we have modest changes in levels of service at that location. They're calculating at D, but we know on Saturday they're really E and F. So the better test, as I said, is Delaware Avenue, but we'll get to that. We'll go next to Bay Avenue and 2nd Street, where weekdays we're calculating A and B, but Friday evening in the summer, C for the westbound approach, which would be leaving the site and heading, heading towards the site, C, but we drop to an E with the addition of site traffic when everybody is leaving the site on a Friday evening on the eastbound approach. Saturday midday, Sunday, Saturday morning, we're calculating at level of service E, but with no changes from the no build to build condition. As I said, Delaware Avenue, we studied the 7 peak hours at both second and 3rd. So Delaware and 3rd, weekday morning, level of service A with or without side traffic. Weekday evening, we go from an A to a B on the eastbound and westbound approaches with the addition of site traffic. Friday evening, B with or without site traffic. Saturday morning, levels of service A and B with or without the addition of site generated traffic. Saturday midday, level of service B with and without site traffic. Saturday evening, we do go from an A to a B on the eastbound and westbound approaches. And Sunday evening, B with or without site traffic. At Delaware Avenue and 2nd Street, we're calculating levels of service A during the weekday morning, evening, peak hours with or without site traffic. Level of service B on a Friday evening with or without site traffic. And again, that's Friday in the summer. Saturday morning, Saturday midday, Saturday evening, and Sunday, level of service B with or without site traffic. And it's because there's very quiet volumes on Delaware Avenue, and of course, even less volume on Pennsylvania because they are, Pennsylvania is a dead end roadway. The figures in the back of the report, just want to give you a sense of the numbers that we counted. The two-way volume on 3rd Street is roughly 60 vehicles, and just under 60 vehicles on a Saturday morning on 2nd. And again, Saturday midday, just under 60 vehicles. So the traffic volumes that are along both Delaware Avenue as well as those side streets, very low volume, so there is the capacity available to accommodate site generated traffic. So the analysis has shown, and we also tested the site driveways, and they operate at acceptable levels of service A and B. So aside from what we all know is a problem on Bay Avenue, we've shown that the site-generated traffic can be accommodated in and out of the site driveways and through the adjacent intersections on Delaware Avenue and Pennsylvania Avenue. And because there will be parking on site, we'll be managing that inbound and outbound flow within designated parking areas without having some of the recirculation that currently occurs as people look for parking. So from this analysis, we've shown that ample capacity exists. I think we have fairly projected the trip generation for a variety of peak hours without taking any credits for other modes of transportation or shared activity between the two proposed uses.
Thank you. Do you have an overall opinion as to whether or not the proposed project will have an adverse impact on parking in the area?
No, I think it will have a positive impact on parking in the area. There's certainly a parking problem. I mean, any time I've been down there, 4 o'clock in the afternoon is one thing, but by 5 o'clock, all the public parking is taken. The restaurants are busy, they're thriving. We're going to be providing, I believe it's 60 spaces over and above what is required by ordinance, which is a buffer, but also I think the reconfiguration of the parking on Pennsylvania Avenue to provide the perpendicular spaces. And I know there was some question about the appropriateness of the tuna club and the fishermen using that parking, but that's an additional 65 spaces in the public right-of-way or partially within the public right-of-way to help, I think, absorb some of the existing parking demand.
Thank you. And Mr. Winkowski, the board traffic engineer, prepared a report dated December 20, 2019. Did you have an opportunity to review that report?
I did, yes.
And I believe we addressed most of the issues. Mr. Winkowski, was there anything else to add?
I know a lot of them were comment type things, but anything to do with the site plan, I think we agree in terms of the signage, striping, and so forth. And but as to the impact analysis, I'll be happy to go through whatever you like.
I had one question on the parking. Have you reviewed any other? I know the township, the borough code, you know, sets a parking standard. My concern would be with the restaurant use. Have you looked at any other resources out there, like ITE, parking generation, to, you know, see what kind of parking would be required for what they do by floor area? It's usually a much smaller rate. And when using seats, it's usually that 1 for 3 or 1 for 4, which would increase the amount of parking for that use. Granted, you know, it is conforming to the borough's code. So just, if you have any comment on that.
I do, I'm not tall enough for this table. I just need a minute to find my notes. Okay, so I did look at parking generation, and again, that's another publication by the ITE, the Institute of Transportation Engineers. And they do have a whole host of different parking ratios. For the hotel, it maxes out at 121, which is comparable to the supply that one per room is pretty typical. For the restaurant, there's all sorts of different restaurant categories. There's different ratios. From my review, I think the 1 for 3 seat is sort of a standard or typical ratio. That's not necessarily ITE, but the ITE sort of flattens out because the samples, the sites that were sampled are so much smaller than what we are proposing. We have calculated trips and seating using the ITE for a couple of different types of restaurants. And the range is from 88 spaces to 325. So, and a lot of that is because the sizes of the study sites were so much smaller. And so I think much like you do with trip generation for a retail development, the curve should start to flatten out after a while. So yes, I think that this is a little bit lower than some of the standards we've seen elsewhere or other ordinances, but because it's in a shared setting, I think if you looked, for example, at a full-service hotel or a resort hotel that would include a restaurant, the number was something like 245 spaces, and that's about what we've got on site. So I think you have to look at the fact that these are going to work together as opposed to calculating the parking independently for each use.
I don't know if you want me to comment on our findings now, but I mean, I could say I did feel that the traffic study was prepared pretty thoroughly. They did seem to analyze all the intersections that I would have questioned. And the report was prepared consistent with the recommendations of ITE, the methodology that you use. The assumptions were reasonable. Engineering judgment into account and which way the traffic's going to be flowing. Parking, you know, I will give the applicants and your credit. I mean, they didn't think any shared parking or shared trips or pass by traffic or interconnection of uses in the analysis. Everything was done independently. I think the site, from a parking standpoint, and I believe this is part of the requirement of the redevelopment plan, is to have mitigating measures and operational system set up, so we rely on valet parking, bike racks, pedestrian activity, making sure it's free flowing.
Right, and I think when Mr. Vernon ultimately testifies, he'll talk about some of the ideas he had. I know he talked about possibly having a shuttle because there was a concern earlier in the evening about the employee parking load. But he's got some ideas about managing that by having to park at other locations and shuttle.
Yeah, that's a significant testimony we're going to need to hear. How we address the potential for the need for more parking than what's being provided.
And the valet was also part of that. I think the valet plan was actually included in the civil site submission. And it showed something like 153 additional spaces could be gained with valet.
And then as far as the traffic impact, I think the report does show that most of the side streets and the side street intersections will be suitable or will not be over-congested with the additional site traffic. Bay Avenue, Bay Avenue, I don't think there's anything that's going to fix that with this application. And what is your opinion as far as your impact on Bay Avenue with trips and the nature of the uses, the peaks, compared to the peaks and the congestion you see on Bay Avenue?
Well, any time you're coming in for the weekend on a Saturday, you're sitting in that traffic. I've done it many times. I think that this is not going to have any measurable or significant impact on Bay Avenue because, and again, Chris Vernon can testify to some of this, but he's thought about different check-in time frames and so forth to help mitigate some of that or bring people in at different times. I think this offers people another place to go in LBI. If they're not renting a house or staying somewhere else, that they're coming here. I do think it's sort of interesting, the commentary earlier about this being a place that people are going to want to go, but I also think that there is parking and other modes of transportation to help mitigate that. So I don't think this is going to have a negative traffic impact, and I think that's been fairly shown by a conservative projection of volume without credits.
I mean, that's all I have right now. I was just pending other comments based on board questions and
Mr. Olin, if you would just refer again to Exhibit A3. Mr. Vecchio testified briefly about the pavers that are at the intersection. They're shown at the intersections of 3rd Street, Pennsylvania Avenue, and also 2nd Street, Pennsylvania Avenue. Do you have an opinion as to what impact, if any, those will have on traffic flow?
What we tried to do was come up with something that would have a real visual impact to the driver, particularly a driver who may not be familiar with the area. From my perspective, those intersections just don't seem to be very well defined, and I think this visual will help to not only create a nice streetscape that blends in with the paver sidewalk system that's proposed, but it'll also allow for a very good visual definition of the crosswalks, and we're going to have more pedestrian activity here. So it's a visual, and it helps to enhance the pedestrian crossings, and I think it's just a very helpful traffic calming type of approach. if, of course, the board and the borough want that type of treatment.
Thank you. And Ms. Dolan, all of your opinions this evening, were they given within a reasonable degree of certainty?
I would say so, yes.
Thank you. I don't have any further questions for Ms. Dolan. At this time, I'll open it to the board.
Thank you.
What happened to the residents on the south half of the island? Everything that you have coming in is coming from the north. You don't have anything coming down Center Street or Angleside. You're going to have a lot of traffic for people that are window shopping for restaurants to go to. I think you neglected to add that in.
I'm not sure I understand the question, that I didn't route the traffic to those other streets.
Well, Center Street's a huge influx of traffic coming from maybe Colgate area, the rest of the town. I think you have people that maybe they want to try Tucker's or maybe the Black Whale, and they go, oh, they're a little busy, so maybe I'm going to shop around and go to the next place. I think you neglected the whole, a couple other major streets.
And I wouldn't say neglected. I would say that the traffic characteristics on Center are comparable to what we counted, if that whole little area over there. If I were to distribute the traffic more to those intersections, that diffuses the amount that we analyzed on Delaware. But I'm certainly in agreement that those roadways are attractive. They're there. They bring you right into the area. If the board felt that the additional analyses were needed, we could certainly look at that. But I don't think that we find anything materially different.
I do. My day job is a police officer.
He knows.
There's lights on 3rd Street and Center Street. I didn't find or couldn't deduce out of this was, what is the stacking going to be like? For example, you're making a left on the boulevard at either of the lighted intersections. I got to believe there's going to be some car stacking trying to go left.
Yeah, it's all in here. I can look for it and find it. I just don't know if I can find it that quickly.
For example, checkout time.
Saturday afternoon. Yeah, and it's going to back up, right? Right. Yeah.
And so I can look through and I can provide that. I know we're coming back. I can get you that answer for the next meeting.
Okay. Just to clarify the discussion of Center Street, I believe wouldn't they have to, the people traveling along Center Street would ultimately have to pass through the intersections that were studied, other than going up Dock Road, correct?
If I'm coming down Holgate, on a Saturday night during the summer, we know that Holgate empties out and come to Beach Haven. Everywhere from Pearl Street north, they turn and they just turn everything. That's why we're here.
I was a little confused when you picked your restaurant type for your trip generation. You're leaning one way, leaning the other way. What did you actually pick for your restaurant?
From the IPs categories, I use the quality restaurant because that gave us numbers for all different periods, including a morning. Mr. Winkowski had also asked me to look at, there's something called a drinking place, and I did look at that, but they did not have a lot of data that was helpful for us.
Because on the weekend, and you say quality place, I think they're all quality places, but we tend to turn the tables over pretty might turn them over 3-4 times on Friday or Saturday night. And I think we you have a stacking for a bar, so the impact is going to be at peak, it's going to be pretty high. You have people coming in and then they're stacking in the bar. Are you talking about?
Well, we had for all of the summer peak periods, we used for each hour 100 entering and 100 exiting.
For the restaurant?
For the restaurant.
But you're talking about 400 seats, and you're also talking about 200 stacked in your waiting area, bar area.
Well, again, I can come back next month with other numbers to give you a range.
Yeah, I just think it's, in the resort area, it's very unusual. It's a quality restaurant, yes. It's also a high turnover.
And the bar activity.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, not the bar activity. Even the restaurant food-wise, they turn very fast.
Well, and I guess some of that should be answered by Chris as well. But I can, like I said, I can give you the trip generation for the other restaurant types.
And the other thing maybe you can answer is, Bay Avenue, we all know the issue, but probably the most critical intersection on Bay Avenue to me on the weekend in the summer is Second and Bay Avenue. And for Saturday night, we didn't do traffic counts. Was there a reason for that?
I think it was just the staffing and the number of periods we were trying to count. I mean, we've really loaded up on the traffic counts, and so we just couldn't get all six intersections for all seven periods.
To me, from my observation through time, probably that is the most critical intersection. Because it's a very pedestrian-oriented intersection, a lot of pedestrian traffic, there's a lot of less, you know, and then there's kind of traffic time as you go by.
Right, right. Well, so we got, I think, 5 peak hours at that location. And it does, it gets down to that E level because it's harder to make the left off of Second, which it's a stop control as opposed to a signal.
Okay. I was just wondering why you didn't count that.
Yeah, it's just a matter of staffing and the amount of time. No, the counts were from August.
I know they were August,
right.
Was there any in July?
No.
I think we should be looking at July.
July.
How do we account for example, during the peak hours, and when you do have people cycling through, you account for those people cycling through in your traffic patterns that aren't specifically going to the restaurant?
Any traffic that was traveling through the intersections during the times we counted was counted. So
I mean, when you extrapolate your numbers out for a specific site, I realize you're using numbers from the IDE.
Yes.
I get that. What about, how do you account for all the traffic where people, how people find spaces, they get in their car and drive around? It may take 12, 15 minutes. But that's not directly because of 400 seats at a restaurant. These people are
so for the proposed restaurant, the parking is on site. So we routed the traffic to the site. We didn't have them circle the block. But if people are circling for any of the other existing restaurants, then that volume was counted in the manual counts that we performed. That's why we got August, but the purpose of the May and September counts was to just count the weekday morning and evening when school was in session. So that was the reason we tested those out. That's typically how a traffic study is done. Here it's a lot different because it's about the shore activity,
this
which
is a beach resort.
Right.
Yeah, so when school's in session, it's kind of irrelevant. So we need to know when the people are there.
Right, which was the purpose of all of the August counts, you know, summertime.
For July.
The school here is 60 kids.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. You perform those counts and analyses for those times because that's the traditional traffic study time period. Certainly, as was shown, there's lower volume during those weekday morning and evening hours outside of the summer than during all of the different summertime periods that we counted. Of course, it's much lower.
30 of them ride your bikes.
So. Well, it was informational purposes. It wasn't the, you know, I think the summer counts and analysis were over all those different periods to capture what's happening as people come on and off the island at the beginning and end of the week.
Just another clarification also. So you had mentioned that when we look at the restaurant, hotel, there's really two different ways to look at those. And one of them was the square footage way for the restaurant, which may not be appropriate, and that we should be using the three seats. And anyway, you had mentioned the number of the restaurant requiring 245 parking spaces. spaces for the restaurant, and then add in the hotel requirements, I think the lot parking is way below what was really required.
Well, the requirement for the, as Mr. Vecchio took you through, we meet and exceed the requirement, and how that requirement was developed, I wasn't a part of that, but the proposal provides more parking than is required by ordinance.
And I said previously also, I don't think the ordinance, I think the ordinance, because this is a special and very different project in Beach Haven, needs to be looked at differently.
Any further questions? Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome.
The only remaining potential witness we have is Kim.
Mr. Ava, we're going to probably stop the meeting at this point.
Sure.
You've already agreed in advance that all of your witnesses will be here next meeting.
Yes.
And any other further meetings in this carries past March, correct?
That's correct. Before anybody leaves, if I would just say, would you please announce when the next meeting is going to be so that we don't have to submit further notice, send out further notice.
Okay, I found out from Jackie Friday, we can use this forum for the March meeting on the date that we have scheduled. We can use the museum next door, Beach Haven Museum. So the next meeting will be March 2nd. It'd be the 3rd of March. March 2nd, 6 o'clock, next door at the Beach Haven Museum. 129 Ingleside Avenue. The applicant does not need to re-notice for that because it's being announced now in public forum. The borough land use board will have to re-notice because it's different from what we had posted previously. So, just so everybody knows, you will not get another notice. Make sure you come back next door.